Second topic was in touch with the EU High Representative's office a short time ago. I believe they have confirmed and have indicated to us that Iran has, in fact, responded to Catherine Ashton, her invitation. Dr. Jalili has sent a formal response. Iran has, proposed a couple of tentative dates. I would expect there will be consultations within the P5+1 in the next day or two. I wouldn't be surprised. There may well be a call between High Representative Ashton and Secretary Clinton this afternoon. I believe there'll be a political directors conference call probably tomorrow, and we will work to nail down with Iran a specific date and location for this meeting. And lastly, yesterday you asked about the question of Iraqi Christians and whether there has been any specific request for asylum in the aftermath of the reprehensible attack recently. The answer is no, but we have not seen any reports of widespread displacement or resettlement, but we are in close contact with Iraq and the UNHCR. We do actually have programs that are already established and functioning. Since 2007, more than 53,000 Iraqi refugees have been resettled in the United States, so we have a program that is available to anyone who has these concerns, but in the immediate aftermath, we have not seen any specific requests.
What's that number again, the date and the number for Iraqis?
Since 2007, 53,700 Iraqi refugees have resettled in the United States. So we have aggressively worked this over the course of years, and obviously we're poised to be of further assistance, but we have seen nothing in the aftermath of that particular attack.
On the Iranian response to the EU invitation, are we talking about a meeting of the P5+1 with them, or are we talking about the smaller Vienna group meeting with them, for one thing?
Well, I think, potentially we would like to see activity both within the context of the P5+1 and also with the context of the IAEA. We're open to Iran engaging through both channels. Right now, we are, Catherine Ashton, propose a meeting later this month, Iran has now indicated it is prepared to move ahead, and we will try to lock in a date and location, very quickly. But to the extent that Iran, wishes to, pursue the Tehran Research Reactor proposal, we are open to that, and that could be something that is done within the context of the Vienna group and through the IAEA, because there are obviously some technical aspects that would have to be fulfilled for that to go forward, including the status of a material that is shipped out of Iran, who controls it, and so forth.
But the meeting we're talking about, on whether it's November 15th or in December or whenever it is, we're talking about a P5+1 meeting?
We are prepared to move forward with a P5+1 meeting, and we'd hope that that might occur as early as the end of this month.
And has the group agreed on the updated proposal that you've referred to in the past?
That is something we still are consulting with our partners on.
There was originally a suggestion, more than a suggestion, that the first meeting would be between Ashton and Jalili alone, a sort of get-to-know-you meeting. Is that what we're talking about here?
Again, we will consult and see how to move forward, but we are prepared to have a P5+1 meeting at a mutually agreeable time and location.
I believe Turkey has come forward and said that it's going to be hosting these talks. Do you know anything about that? And how do you see the role of Turkey in this engagement?
I don't believe that we've arrived at this point at either a date or a location. That will be what we'll be consulting with our partners, and then in turn back to Iran.
But the role of Turkey and where you see them fitting in I think
our, you know, I mean, our immediate focus is to have a meeting of the P5 plus one. That was what occurred just over a year ago, and we would like to see a series of meetings. You know, those meetings could happen in different locations. So we're open to a variety of ideas here, but I think we're focused on one side is a P5 plus one, you know, meeting. Now, our major concern is, of course, Iran's nuclear intentions, but within the context of the P5 plus one, we're open for other issues that, you know, might be discussed. Obviously, in any kind of engagement that would occur with the IAEA in the context of the TRR, you know, there's potential for that kind of a meeting as well. But I think our immediate focus here is to try to get, you know, and not just one meeting, but a process through which, through the P5 plus one, we can address our concerns about Iran's nuclear programs and any other issues that Iran wants to bring to the table.
Iran's response said specifically they want it, they think it should take place in Turkey, which seems to be an effort to bring at least the Turks in and potentially the Brazilians, given that they were the facilitators of the last offer. What's your view on whether or not, if we are talking about the TRR at this stage, should the Turks and the Brazilians be a part of it?
Again, I'll come back to what we would like to have is a meeting within the context of the P5 plus one. If we get a process going, then we'll see where that process leads. But we want to see a return to the kind of meeting that we had just over a year ago. We thought it was a productive meeting, and we'd like to see it be a series of meetings, not just one. You know, these are, you know, difficult, complex issues, and clearly, you know, none of these issues can be resolved in a single meeting.
That they're talking about the same thing you're talking about, a P5 plus one, or are they talking about a broader group?
Well, we're going to have a conversation back through High Representative Ashton, but we, you know, Iran appears in its response to be open to a meeting and relatively soon, and we're going to try to lock down a date, a location, and then begin to work the details of the
they're
meeting.
They're open to a P5 plus one meeting, you say?
Well, I mean, that is, you know, I believe that we are talking about having a P5 plus one meeting as soon as one can be put together.
The Iranians say we're ready to have a meeting, but not to talk about our nuclear intentions. Is the U.S. willing to go to the meeting?
Well, that's a hypothetical. You know, at the top of our list is Iran's nuclear intentions. I mean, notwithstanding, as I recall, there were similar suggestions publicly prior to the meeting last year, but when we got together, the nuclear issue was of paramount importance in that meeting. No, not yet. Not so fast.
You just said what Charlie was saying. You immediately said that might be a hypothetical issue, but we're hearing from Iranian officials that they only want to talk. They will talk about anything but their nuclear program. So are you going to get anything?
We want a meeting, and at that meeting we plan to talk about the nuclear issue.
So this doesn't surprise you. What's
happening? I'm not certain that's actually the Iranian position either.
Position to Turkey hosting this meeting, if that's what Iran wants?
Well, look, you know, first and foremost, we want a meeting. We want to put it together as soon as possible in a location that is convenient for all of the participants. We'll consult tomorrow and then respond with our own answer to the Iranian response. If we are successful in getting a process going, not just one meeting, but a series of meetings and a serious engagement on the nuclear issue and other issues, we can envision that there would be many potential locations for this series of meetings. But we'll consult in the next day with our partners in the P5 plus one process, or for the Europeans, the E3 plus three process, and then we'll respond formally to Iran through High Representative Ashton.
Is Turkey convenient for you?
We'll see. We're going to consult with our partners.
But don't you need to have an agreement, an advance agreement about the agenda? Because the Iranians are imposing their own agenda.
Again, Samir, these are all good questions. You want to lock in a date and location? And then we'll make clear, what we're prepared to talk about. Iran will probably have its own issues. As I recall, last year the meeting was predominantly about the nuclear issue, but on the sidelines there was the opportunity to talk about other things. And we'll come to the table prepared to talk about a range of issues, but obviously at the top of our list is the Iran nuclear program.
Sorry, just one more thing on the process here. I just want to make sure we're talking about first is a meeting between Ashton and the Iranians. This potential P5+1 meeting that you're talking about.
Isn't that
what was initially on offer? Well, isn't that what her letter said to them?
Put it this way: if you go back to prior meetings were preceded by a meeting between an Iranian representative and the European High Representative. It depends. Iran offered a couple of dates. We have a couple of dates in mind. It may well be that there's a preliminary meeting. It may well be that we go right to the first meeting. I'm not prejudging, both what we're prepared to do and what Iran is prepared to do. We will consult with High Representative Ashton in the next day, and then, we want to get this process going, and we want it to be a process.
Undersecretary Bill Burns will be the U.S. representative if and when there's a meeting in the next
I would expect it would be at the political director's level, yes.
Just to go back to the TRR update, can you give us a sense of how far along those talks are? Do you plan to present a new proposal when this meeting does
happen? Obviously, in the meeting last year, we put the TRR proposal on the table. That is something that we are prepared, to offer an updated version of that. It's possible that this could be something that is discussed again, if and when a meeting takes place. Okay, Michelle.
On the Israeli announcement to build 1,300 new apartments in East Jerusalem, yesterday you said that somebody in Israel has made this known in order to embarrass the Prime Minister and to undermine the process.
Today, I suggested that as a possibility.
Yeah, but today Israeli Prime Minister's office has issued a statement defending the announcement, saying that Jerusalem is not a settlement, it's the capital of the State of Israel. Israel sees no link between the peace process and its development plans in Jerusalem. What's your reaction to that?
Well, there clearly is a link in the sense that it is incumbent upon both parties, as we've insisted all along, that they are responsible for creating conditions for a successful negotiation. To suggest that this kind of announcement would not have an impact on the Palestinian side, I think is incorrect. We do understand that Israel has its own position on these kinds of announcements. That said, we have indicated that we think these kinds of announcements at this time even if it's a process that's going to carry over for months, if not years, are counterproductive to our efforts to get the parties into a direct negotiation. So we haven't changed our view.
The Prime Minister's statement came immediately after, or very soon after, the President made his own criticism of the settlement announcement. Don't they appear to be hardening their position? Or explicitly rejecting the U.S. stance on this going into the Secretary's meeting?
Again, the Secretary looks forward to her meeting with the Prime Minister on Thursday. I have confidence that this will be among the subjects discussed.
Do you think she'll be expressing her irritation?
I'm confident that there'll be a meeting in New York.
From your language that there is.
Just on that point, we're still working on the venue. I think it'll be probably the meeting will start somewhere early in the morning around 9 o'clock. We're still trying to nail down precisely where it will take place. There have been a couple of different possibilities broached.
The Palestinians have responded saying that if the Israelis are going to take unilateral action, the international community should go ahead and create a state of Palestine.
And this is why we've had a consistent position throughout that both sides have to avoid unilateral actions that that, you know, really, you know, poison the atmosphere and prevent progress towards negotiations, which, again, is the only means through which we can resolve these issues once and for all.
What can you say about the peace process? Is there any process? Is there anything?
Well, there's absolutely a process. What we're looking for is to make progress, and that is something that we continue to aggressively seek. Samir.
The announcement of the transfer of funds to the Palestinians, will this be a new money or from the $900 million of last year?
Samir, you're asking me to step on tomorrow's news. Look, we have been the leading contributor to the Palestinian Authority and the ongoing efforts of President Abbas and Prime Minister Fayyad to make a difference on the ground in the Palestinian territories. We're in a new fiscal year. We'll have the opportunity to make an additional contribution, to the Palestinian Authority. And beyond that, we'll wait for the Secretary's visit here tomorrow.
So this additional to the $900
million? Again, you know, we have obviously contributed a significant amount of money to the Palestinian Authority to support its ongoing efforts at building the institutions that will be vital to a future Palestinian state. We are in a position with a new fiscal year, to make an additional contribution, and I'll leave it there in terms of a teaser, and we'll wait for more details tomorrow.
Meeting with the Minister tomorrow. Is she going to have any special focus on, for instance, the Arab League and what they may or may not be doing in the next couple of weeks? Does she have any special requests?
I would anticipate the meeting tomorrow with Foreign Minister Abolgeit will cover bilateral issues. Egypt is approaching important elections coming up. We'll talk about in Middle East peace. The Egyptians have had their own meetings in the region in recent days, and I'm sure we'll give the Secretary an update on their perspective and clearly, what happens in terms of, regional support for our ongoing efforts is a critical dimension of that.
Since the launch of of President Obama's initiative for peace in the Middle East, we have seen nothing from the Israelis but lip service from the Prime Minister of Israel concerning the peace. On one side, on the other side, they are building faster than ever their new settlements on the Arab lands. Now, the only comforting thing in the Middle East is what they hear from Secretary Clinton, is her determination along with the President, President Obama, about pursuing the peace process. But now, do you all have any new look or new strategy to deal with this lip service kind of policy of the Israelis when it comes to peace, that you could really do something that would make a difference from now on, since they have proven that they don't really have the sincerity pursuing this?
Well, let me unpack your question and perhaps challenge some ingredients in there. We are focused on the direct negotiation. It is the only path to obtain the peace that we believe is vitally important for the Israeli people, the Palestinian people, the Syrian people, the Lebanese people, and everyone else in the region. This is the only way forward. It's not about lip service. It's about a negotiation. It's not about making one-off gestures. It's about the means of tackling the very complex issues and unwinding the difficult history in the region and focusing on the future, not being a captive to the past. We are determined, as you said, and this is why the Secretary has been intensely engaged. The President has been engaged. George Mitchell and others have made countless trips to the region. We appreciate the efforts of others, including Senator Kerry, who has had his own discussions, and recall that we're talking about multiple contexts here, not just peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians, but peace between the Israelis and the Syrians, and the Israelis and the Lebanese. We are determined to try to make progress on all paths towards a comprehensive peace. That is our goal. When we came into this, we knew this would be difficult. But we are determined, and we are continuing to work with the parties to try to find a way to make progress.
Sir, I just want to make sure that I meant the Israelis' lip service, not the American lips. I didn't mean
again,
any way that American lips.
If you're in a direct negotiation, then, I mean, I recognize that outside of a negotiation, there can be just the back and forth of public comments. That's why we are pressing both sides, because inside a negotiation, you're dealing with the substance, and that's where we want the parties to go.
Senator Kerry seems to have had a good visit with President Assad, and President Assad has praised President Obama's efforts to bring peace to the Middle East. But do you have any reading of the meeting as State Department?
I'm confident that we have received a back brief from Senator Kerry. I have not, so I it was important meetings that he had both in Damascus and in Beirut, and it demonstrates that we recognize that we are in search of comprehensive peace, and that remains our focus.
Thank you.